My name is Samia Mora. I'm a cardiologist at the Brigham and Women's Hospital and associate professor of medicine at Harvard Medical School. I just presented today at the 23rd Annual World Congress on Heart Disease and the International Academy of Cardiology. And I talked about non-fasting lipids, and the title of my talk was NPO No More. So for lipid testing, I presented data regarding three main points. The first point is that fasting lipids are no longer necessary for routine management and care of patients. The second point, I presented the data behind that. There's a big evidence base. And the third point was I showed that the changes with routine eating in general during daily activities is actually not really very big. So the first point is that many reasons to start doing non-fasting lipid testing. For one, patients prefer it. For second, it's more safe. There are some patients, elderly or patients with diabetes or frail patients who actually have even passed out while they're waiting to get testing. It causes repeat visits, so many patients have to come back again to get tested if they weren't fasting when they come to see the doctor or the healthcare provider. It also decreases the workflow for the labs. You know, the labs have all the patients coming at 8 a.m. in the morning, so it's very hard for them when all the patients are coming in fasting. And most importantly, there's no good reason. You know, we used to think that we need to be fasting because of the Friedwald calculation for LDL cholesterol. However, there are many ways around that in terms of one can do non-HDL cholesterol, one can also do apolipoprotein B, and these measures do not really change. Even Friedwald LDL cholesterol actually does not substantially change. In fact, it decreases a little bit, about 2 to 4 or 5 milligram per deciliters after eating, but it's really very, very small. It's not really clinically significant change. And triglycerides, which is the main reason people say you should fast, because after eating, most people's triglycerides can go up by about 15 or 20%. Some patients, those with diabetes or certain predisposition to having big chylomicron particles, their triglycerides can actually go up a lot more, say 30 or 40%. But even in those patients, and we have found, and many studies have found now, that non-fasting triglycerides is a really good way to figure out, is the body able to handle the stress of eating, and how does the body respond? So people who have these exaggerated triglyceride responses, increases after eating, they're actually at increased risk for CVD. So if we tested them when they're fasting, we would not identify that they're at this increased risk. We have study from the Women's Health Study, a large study of about 30,000 women who were followed prospectively for over 20 years. And we identified that in these women, about a quarter of them had their lipids done non-fasting, while the 75% had them fasting. The 25% who actually had them non-fasting, we were able to pick up these subtle changes in triglycerides and found that the non-fasting triglyceride was a much better predictor of risk than the fasting. So you may ask, well, what cut point should we do? You know, if we take non-fasting triglycerides, what cut point should we be worried about clinically for the patient if their triglycerides are high? What is high for a non-fasting triglyceride? So in our study, what we found was that a triglyceride cut point of 175 milligram per deciliter, which is just about 2 millimoles per liter, that's the cut point that actually identifies increased risk when it's done non-fasting. Now, in general, we tell patients, well, you know, you shouldn't have a very big fat load right before you go for lipid testing, but most patients do not, you know, have a big fat load right before going to see their healthcare provider. So it turns out, from a practical standpoint, patients are already doing this. And in fact, what we found for the Friedwald calculation of the LDL cholesterol, that non-fasting Friedwald LDL cholesterol was substantially increased risk of CVD compared with the fasting. So it also seems to pick up these patients who have these abnormalities in their lipid metabolism that we would not capture if we tested people who are fasting. Now, as it turns out, over the past several years, guidelines in both Europe, the United States, and Canada have been gradually changing to identify that and to recommend non-fasting lipid tests. So guidelines from Europe, from the UK, the NICE guidelines, the British Society's guidelines, followed the Danish guidelines that came out earlier in 2009. In the US, the 2014 Department of Defense and VA guidelines recommended non-fasting way back in 2014. More recently, 2017, the American Association of Clinical Endocrinology and the American Endocrinology Society, they also recommended that non-fasting can be used and it's more practical. So we hope that the American Heart Association, American College of Cardiology guidelines, which actually also do recommend non-fasting, in particular if one is going to look at non-HDL cholesterol or ApoB. So focusing on these other measures can also provide information for cardiovascular risk prediction. So to summarize, what we talked about today was that non-fasting lipids can be routinely done for almost all patient scenarios. There are some situations where a healthcare provider may want to repeat an elevated non-fasting triglyceride, for example, triglyceride above 400 or 440 milligram per deciliter. However, even in those cases where it is repeated, we found that there isn't that much additive information unless one really wants to just document a fasting level for the triglyceride. For the non-fasting triglyceride, keep in mind the cut point of 175 milligram per deciliter. That corresponds roughly to a fasting of 150 milligram per deciliter, above which that the risk of CVD increases. And of course, if a non-fasting triglyceride is much greater than 175 milligram per deciliter, then that patient is at much increased risk for cardiovascular disease and should be have optimal interventions, including lifestyle and potentially medical therapies. So in summary, non-fasting lipids can be used routinely for most practical purposes. Patients prefer that, healthcare providers prefer that, and labs prefer that. And most importantly, we're also now being consistent with the guidelines that have built on this big evidence base to support these recommendations.